We're missing a few.
You need to stop. Aim the other way.
Oh, we got everybody.
Honey, you are not that special to get a shout out. Okay.
Aim the other way.
Yeah, I think you are.
This is 14 is very long. Yeah. Okay. Because week 2 it's still 8 and 14. So we have it's only the first day of week 1.
You must have heard from
Monday.
Tuesday.
Or Tuesday. Tuesday. Yeah. Whatever we cover today will be on Tuesday's quiz.
Yeah, my candy. Is this from the kids in press phone?
Yeah, for the lecture, but not part of that quiz.
Okay.
CT uses computer-based X-rays to give you slices, cross-sectional slices. The organ that you're studying, if it's the brain, then it's the brain. All right. It says to remove all metal objects. I don't think that's necessary for a CT scan, but it would be necessary for MRI. Okay. Then. Iodine allergy and also allergies to shellfish.
Yes.
Now, like I told you earlier, the dye is used, upon this medium is used, there's a warm flush feeling once the dye is injected.
Just pause and read it.
It goes in, in quickly, it starts quickly and ends quickly.
It was going on YouTube, right?
And after the procedure, you ask the patient to use oral fluid intake to help eliminate the dye rapidly. So these are examples of the images that you can see with a CT scan. So that's a two. What is one other thing you need to ask the patient?
If they have troubles in confined spaces, you can or tight spaces.
Or what's that called? Claustrophobia. Irrational fear of tight and closed spaces. All right.
I don't know what she's doing here.
I don't know why they put that picture there. I'll take it out. The brain scan. It uses radiation, just like CT scan, an older technology, so it's not used much anymore, so they just do the CT scan more frequently. And okay, care of unconscious patients. So there are several syndromes that you need to master first before you go to the specific diseases. So one probably is loss of consciousness, or level of consciousness. Two is increased intracranial pressure, and three is seizures. So we will discuss these three first, because a lot of the disorders will involve any or a combination of these group of disorders. So if the patient is unconscious, what's the most important thing is, what's the highest priority?
Airway. Always
ABC, it's always airway, okay? Inadequate oxygenation, positioning the patient. How should you position the patient?
If you do
what's the best way? If you're thinking of airway.
Wait.
Patient is unconscious.
Are we walking in on them being unconscious? Like, on the out? Or, yeah, because it's different. Are we walking in and they just like passed out, like in the.
No. You have a patient that is an unconscious patient. Oh, so you're thinking of airway, right?
Yeah.
So you don't want them to suffocate or to have aspiration pneumonia. So your patient is unconscious. You know, you assign to a patient who's unconscious. Let me just put it that way. He's newly unconscious, but that patient is comatose.
Sidelines. Oh, comatose? Okay, then.
Yeah. What is important is you want to keep the airway straight, or you want to keep it painted. So you don't flex the neck. So probably you extend, better to extend the neck without really extending it too. Don't hyperextend it. So it has to be open. So that's the position that we're talking about. Suctioning if there's a need. So usually it's suctioning PRN. See, avoid flexion of the head. Because when you flex the head, so if you put a big pillow at the back, what's the effect of that?
It's going to squish the
forward, right?
Squish the airway.
So it will kink or obstruct the airway. The airway is right here, right? So if it's flexed like that, then you're actually closing or obstructing the airway. Then these are the assessments. Level of consciousness, what's the tool you use for this? Glasgow Coma Scale, the GCS. The pupils, okay. How do you examine for the pupils?
Perla, you do reaction to light.
You said Perla?
But you can't really do Perla.
So do you spell Perla with one L or two L's?
Two.
Okay.
It's two R's.
I thought you said two R's.
Two R's, one L.
Wait. What's the A stand for?
One L.
Listening pupils, equal reactive, light, and two A's.
Equal reactive.
Tell me what you mean by this.
Pupil equal round reactive light accommodation.
Accommodations, hey.
Pupils equally round and reactive to light
and accommodation. With accommodation.
And this is what you report on the documentation after you perform that testing, right?
I don't even like Perla.
What if their last name is Perla?
The assessment. Really?
Perla is Perla.
Tell me, how do you
do accommodation?
Accommodation. Because you're documenting it, so it means you did it, right?
Isn't that when you do the lecture, right?
That's a finger following test. You want to check, you're testing the...
It's when you shine the light.
You're testing the movement of the eyeballs. So if you do not do it, or if you don't know how to do it, you have no business documenting it, right? Because nurses always tell the truth. Never make untrue entries. And actually, that is the right answer. Mr. Rodriguez has just... Can you come in here and tell us?
So I have to come back out.
Yeah. Can you tell us how to do the accommodation?
The
dummy. Okay. We prefer dummy. So, that's
follow nice. My finger.
That's not nice. That's
my friend.
Your head is very...
And what are you observing if you are doing that? That's the right way to do it, but... How can you tell if there's accommodation or no accommodation?
If they can follow it.
You can follow it with what? The eyeballs?
Okay, do it again.
Yeah, with just the eyeballs.
No.
Accommodations with light.
You gotta reevaluate your whole career now.
It's not like people can shoot some light over there. That's accommodation.
Accommodation, okay. That's right. I always see this in the assessments of the students. But then when I ask the student, what is accommodation, they don't know. They don't even know, and it's there in their documentation. Isn't that strange? Now,
I always put pearl.
Yeah, it's better to do that if you didn't check this, right? Yeah. And accommodation is actually a test of your eye in general. For now, I'll just say in general, accommodating from far vision to close vision and vice versa.
Mm-hmm.
Close to far and far to close. Now, for example, if there are three responses that you should be observing, although one I think you cannot really observe, but one is pupillary reaction. Number two is eyeball reaction, and three is the lens reaction. So all three parts of the eyeball or the eye will react to accommodation, from, let's say, from far to close. So what do you think will the eyeballs do? It diverge or converge?
Well, it depends which way you're going.
So from far to near, let's just say far to near. The eyeball will, there will be convergence. The pupils, will it constrict?
Depends
or
which
dilate?
Way you're going. Far to near, constrict.
It will constrict. From far to near, it will constrict. Because if it's from near to far, you're trying to look at a more distant thing, so you need more light. to come into the eyeball so that you can see more clearly, because distant objects are harder to see than nearer objects, right? So for a near object, you don't need much light because it's near. So constrict, and the lens will try to change into the muscles that control the lens will make it into a more convex configuration, more convex shape. But you cannot observe this, right? But these two you can. That's why I said there are three changes, but you can observe only two. That is an accommodation. Now, from near to far, it's just the opposite of all of this. Now that is accommodation, right? So next time, you know what you're talking about.
I have to recheck that. That is just cool.
All right. Then reflexes, the reflexes that we're talking about, the pupillary light reflex. Oh, yeah, you just mentioned a comment. How about the pupillary light reflex?
Constriction. And they do it on the other side.
It's a reflex, so there's a stimulus and an effect.
Mm-hmm.
So let's start with the stimulus. What's the stimulus here?
It's the introduction of light.
A pen light, you shine a light on the pupil, right?
Yeah.
Let's say the right is the patient, this is the right and the left pupil. So I will shine the light on the left pupil. What will happen to the normal if a response to the light?
Look at small.
The right pupil will also constrict.
The pupils will constrict because it will regulate the amount of light coming into the eye. Okay? So it will constrict the right pupil. What happens to the left pupil, the right pupil?
Constricts as well.
Supposed to be. They will always go together. So you observe
supposed
both. So you're shining on the left eye, the pupil will constrict. The pupil on the other eye, contralateral eye, will also constrict. Then you check the other side, they should also constrict at the same time. And they should be equal. So that's why you say equally round. So if it's not round, you cannot say equally round. If it's not equal in reaction, maybe one is more sluggish than the other one,
like
then that's not equal. Or maybe the size are not equal too. Okay? And that condition is known as anisocoria.
Means lazy.
That's an equal size of the pupil. So the pupil, one side will be dilated, the other is constricted. That's not normal. Okay? So there's a problem in the brain, or at least in the optic nerve. All right. So the other reflex we already mentioned, the corneal reflex, a test of the cranial nerve 5, trigeminal nerve, and the cranial nerve 3, or the oculomotor nerve. Then you maintain normal and physiologic functioning of the body. So the vegetative functions, nutrition elimination for both the number 2 and number 1. Okay, you must have the patient be able to perform these bodily functions. Prevent complications as a result of immobility and comatose state. Immobility was the big risk here.
Contractions.
Contractures.
And ulcers.
Decubitus ulcers, right? So for contractors, what do you do? Nursing intervention?
ROM.
Universal?
Yeah.
ROM, active or passive. For decubitus ulcers, to prevent that, what's the? Every?
2 hours.
2 hours from one side to side. Good. They will ask that question over and over and over again. I don't know why. Because they really want to emphasize that. Okay. And they will present different scenarios. But the answer is the same. The intervention would be the same. Okay? You just have to recognize immobility. Okay? Then, okay, you try to give support as the patient's condition changes. You try to avoid oversedation. It says here, touch therapy. I don't know if that will really work, but probably it does. And environment, lighting of the room, you also, the patient is starting to improve, so he could see better. So try to, just like you, if you cannot sleep, if there is too much glare, or too much light in the room, then you lower it down too, okay? And the noise, the environment, you control the environment. where the patient is. Because you think that comatose patients can't hear, they can hear. In fact, they say this is the last thing to go. It's when they encourage the relatives, the close relatives, that to talk to their comatose patients. Even if they're dying, they can probably still hear you. Okay? And the next one is increased intracranial pressure. What can cause increased intracranial pressure? What
tumor.
A tumor?
Yes.
Yes. What else? What's that, Michelle?
Bleeding. Ooh, somebody said edema.
Inflammation.
Bleeding, inflammation. What is your lovely
infection?
Wow.
Pancreatitis. No, it's intracranial.
I came up
with
my aneurysm.
Okay, any space occupying lesion in the cranial cavity, intracranial cavity.
Even like outside things getting in there?
No, inside. Warm? It has to be inside. Because you see, this skull.
Parasites.
Inside is the cranial cavity, right? So what are inside? We've been through this earlier.
Some brains.
It's the brain and?
The blood barrier.
Cerebral spinal fluid.
CSF, that's in there. Okay? So anything that will increase the volume of the contents of the intracranial cavity, will increase the pressure. Because this is an adult skull. It's not going to expand. The baby skull,
well,
up to infancy, has the open fontanelles, right?
Mm-hmm. The holes?
The fontanelle here and here, and the posterior one here.
That's the bulb.
So before it closes, it allows the skull to change shape, allow it to increase in volume. But once it closes, that skull is fixed. The space is fixed. So just like this bottle, if it's full of water, every time you add more and you keep it closed, the pressure will increase until it will burst. Right? It's the same thing there. It's an enclosed space, and then you increase the volume. Any volume, so might be fluid. So might be fluid. So might be edema fluid, might be blood. Now, if it's an infection, might be pus,
brain
abscess, for example, and then might be solid, like a tumor or a mass. Could be a brain tumor or a tumor of the glia cells. Right? What else? Inflammatory flu. We already have edema. What else? Anything that will increase the volume of the intracranial cavity will increase the ICP.
How about handstands?
And if it keeps on increasing, what do you think is the most easily damaged?
The brain.
It's the brain tissue, right? It will not damage the
lining.
The skull right away, and the fluid is just the fluid. And some patients will have an increase in CSF because it's not going to be drained. Now, CSF pathway is it will be produced, it will be released into the cavity, and then it is drained. At any time when this drainage is blocked, then it will just keep on producing it, and it will accumulate in the cavity, and that is a condition that would lead to hydro, meaning for water.
Cephalus.
Is
that when they drill a hole in your head?
Yeah, they can do that, you know. In children, again, babies, that can happen, but their heads will accommodate. So they can have very, very big heads.
So you got the bobblehead?
I don't have pictures of that, but there are a lot of pictures of that on the internet with hydrocephalus. The English would say hydrocephalus. So what can increase it? It's all here, brain tumor, edema, embolism, thrombosis, hemorrhage, and hydrocephalus. Okay, symptoms will be headache, vomiting, papil edema, pupils. And the type of vomiting here would be a projectile vomiting, which is really, it will come out with a very strong force. Commonly seen, that's why you observe for this projectile vomiting patients with head trauma. So patients who had a fall hitting the head, okay, then there would be edema, right? Reaction to the trauma would be edema, or if there's bleeding, then it would bleed. So it would increase the volume, increase the intracranial pressure. Patient can have vomiting, and the type of vomiting is projectile vomiting. When you have projectile vomiting, then there is a significant increase in the ICP already. Okay? So these are the other findings. Like I told you, unilateral dilation of the pupils, so the pupils are not equal in size. Only one side is dilated. That means it's pressing on one part of the, one side of the brain only. Then vertigo, what is that sensation again of vertigo?
Conchella?
Huh?
The feeling of falling? With the conchella?
Or in the conchella, right? Yeah. So what how do you, what's the description of vertigo? That's what I'm asking.
Like the
height?
Yeah.
It's like having a hangover without the fun.
It's actually your surroundings would be going around in circle, and you have the feeling that you will fall over, but that's the main sensation, that your surrounding is going around. Okay? And that can be a very uncomfortable feeling. If you felt it before, that's really, really bad. And when you lie down, actually, after a while, it gets
worse.
It gets better. But when you try to get up again, then, like you said, it's an inner ear problem.
Would that also be affected with the cranial nerve seven?
Facial? I don't
know. Or
think
was it
so.
Ear?
Maybe eight. The auditory. It's the vestibular. Okay. So these are the symptoms. This cartoon that will show you the symptoms of increased ICP, so changes in level of consciousness, headache, pupillary changes. See, they're not equal in size. Only one side is dilated. Papule edema, Dall's eyes. Dall's eye phenomenon.
Never heard.
They don't have many dolls for sale now, right?
Annabelle.
And what happens when, well, they're modern dolls. The old dolls in the 60s and 70s, when you move the head of the doll, what happens to the eyes? Does it go with the movement or does it stay?
It stays.
So that's the doll's eye phenomenon.
Okay.
That's why it's named after that.
That's like Conjuring.
Yeah.
That's like that.
When you were playing with dolls when you were a kid,
shots fired.
I don't know. Who had the opportunity to play
those with
dolls?
Those are action figures.
Yeah, those are not dolls.
Okay.
Those are guy dolls. They're dolls.
G.I. Joe's.
Yeah.
Okay, so that is where, Jane's not a Barbie. The term adult's eye phenomenon is. Then you check for sensory motor function. Then vomiting, what type of vomiting again?
Projectile.
Okay, infants.
So you get a bob and weave.
The fountain nose become bulging. You know, you could feel it. It's usually flat, normally. But then it bulges because of the increased increased pressure. That's actually the fluid that will be bulging there. Especially when the baby is crying.
Poor baby.
It's more noticed when the baby is crying. All right? Increase in head circumference, so that's the beginning of hydrocephalus.
You know all about making
and
cry,
the man. Cry is high pitch cry. Okay, common disorders of the neurological system, increased ICP. So treatment initially would be medical. I will show you later, or it could be mechanical decompression, surgery.
So you go
either
in there and
by
press it.
Craniotomy and craniectomy. Is there a difference?
Yes.
Yes.
It's removal of the brain.
Otomy
is an incision.
The open.
Surgical incision.
Otomy is and ectomy is taken out, right?
What do you take out? You take out the brain?
No.
You take out a piece of the skull.
Take out the brain.
Okay. That's basically, craniotomy is just making a hole. And then you relieve the pressure. If you want to drain the excess fluid, you can do that. And then put the flap back inside. The flap. There's a skin flap and then the bone back. That's a craniotomy. You just made a hole. Craniectomy is you do a craniotomy, but you don't put the flap back right away, or the part that you that you took out, the part of the skull that you took out. You might keep it in abdominal flap or in a special refrigerator to put back in the later time. So that's a craniectomy. So you have taken out part of the cranium. Craniotomy is just you made a hole. Then you just repair it after. All right? Then internal monitoring devices. Okay, conservative treatment. Removal of the CSF. The problem with this, like when you do a lumbar puncture to remove the CSF, if the pressure is very high and then you suddenly put a pressure in, it would cause a vacuum-like pull on the brain structures, and it could lead to what is known as an herniation of the brain tissue.
It goes somewhere it's not supposed to.
Like an uncal herniation, and that could lead to sudden death. That's the problem. That is why even a suspicion of increased intracranial pressure is a relative contraindication for doing a spinal tap or lumbar tap because of the danger risk of herniation. Okay, so that's the reason why they have to make sure that there's no possibility of increased intracranial pressure before they do a lumbar tap. Now, other want to dehydrate the patient, we give hypertonic solution like D10 water. So remember osmotic diuresis. We were in renal system. Mm-hmm. Osmotic diuresis is when you draw with increased osmolality of your sugar, we'll draw the fluid and then it will go to the kidneys and the kidneys will produce more urine. Same thing with mannitol. Mannitol is the best known osmotic diuretic, if you remember. Lasix, high ceiling loop diuretic, furosemide, is the generic name. Steroids and decadron will help reduce the edema of the brain because it's an anti-inflammatory. You know, steroids have anti-inflammatory effects. Decadron, the generic name is dexamethasone. And restriction of fluid, because you already have an excess of fluid, edema fluid, so you restrict it to 800 to 1200 cc per day. Position, head of bed, 15 to 30 degrees angle, what do you call this position? Semi-Fowler's. That is to, if it's, the head is elevated, then the pressure would be less by gravity alone. Right? If you keep that patient supine, worse in the Trendy-Lenberg position, then you're just adding up to the pressure. The T position, remember? You tilt the bed, down. Head down. So head. So that's the Trendy-Lenberg position, right? So you can see that all the fluids are going into the head, right? So that will increase the pressure. That's not good. So better to use the low Fowler's or semi-Fowler's. But just low Fowler's because it's 15 to 30 degrees. Now, part of the nursing care, this one, it says 30 to 40 degrees without flexing the neck. What happens if you flex the neck?
It's gonna crush the esophagus.
You're gonna stop the airway, okay? So you see, there are a lot of these nursing care. You have to know the rationale for each, right? So that you just remember what you want to avoid. So administer fluid slowly and then reduce training by the patient. So any Valsalva maneuver will increase the pressure when the patient coughs, when the patient has to strain, when he's trying to poop really hard stool.
But it's contraindicated for animals.
Huh?
Oh.
You try to prevent that straining because it will increase the pressure. The pressure's already increased. So you try to give stool softeners for that. Okay?
But not animals. But not animals.
But, yeah, for patients with increased ICP, you give a... You give a
stool softener.
Stool
enemas.
Softeners, yeah. But not enemas.
Yeah.
Hypothermia would also reduce your, put them in a hypothermic bed or what do you call this? And maybe chamber.
Hmm?
It's hypothermic, meaning low temperature. Because the lower the temperature, your metabolism is also lower, so that will also lower your intracranial pressure. And so limit painful procedures, and space out nursing activities. So give the patient plenty of rest. So don't do everything at the same time. So you do one procedure now, then you let the patient rest, and you come back for another one. Now let's finally go to the other common disorders. Mm-hmm. Disorders in muscle tone and motor function. It could be flaccid or hyperreflexic muscle tone. It could just be clumsiness or incoordination or abnormal gait. For example, patients with this will be helped with medical management by muscle relaxants. And your patients with patients with clumsiness or incoordination, they're at risk for what?
ICP. Hand eye.
They're at risk for falls. So therefore, your intervention would be protect from falls. Okay, and positioning, and also sit up and tuck chin when eating. What good will this do?
Protect the aspiration.
Protect choking and aspiration. So you do this normally when you're eating and something might be difficult to swallow. You do it like that, right? You do it naturally, right? So you could also use that to instruct the patient to do that when the patient is having a problem with swallowing. That can help the patient swallow better. And assist with the ADLs, activities of daily living. Now, the next one are the epilepsy or seizures. I used to have a lot of videos that would show all of these type of seizures. There's the grand mal. Grand mal is generalized. Everything, every part of the body will be in seizure. It's the Jacksonian. Sometimes Jacksonian would start with a focal seizure and then it will progress, so they call it the Jacksonian march. So it will progress to a full-blown grand mal seizure. Okay? Status epilepticus. What do you understand by status epilepticus?
They have, what is it, epilepsy?
Epilepticus that does not respond, epilepsy or seizure that does not respond to the usual medications for seizure. Okay, so you'll need a stronger medication or a combination of individual other interventions, maybe up to the point of giving general anesthesia, really, to stop the seizure. But you need to be ready to support the airway if you resort to that. Just think also of status asthmaticus. Have you heard that term? Asthma that will not respond to the usual medications. This one is status epilepticus. Seizure that will not respond to the usual usual medication.
Which one are you talking about?
This one is status epilepticus. Where is it?
Push pause.
Go down there.
Yeah, here. Now, if it's asthma, it's known as status asthmaticus. Okay, I'm just making the correlation so you know that's what.
You can't stop the seizure?
It will not stop with the usual medication. Like I said, then you have to use other methods all the way up to general anesthesia. That should stop it, right? General anesthesia. And then diagnosis, the procedure of choice for seizures is always electroencephalogram, EEG, because it's an electrical problem. Your brain, for some reason, keeps on firing electrical impulses. And when you look at it in the graph of an EEG, it could be like crazy, like just like when the earthquake, the Richter scale. Have you seen videos of the Richter scale? When there's an active, strong earthquake, it goes crazy like that. Mm-hmm. Same thing with the EEG. It will look like that. The tracing will look like that. All right. Now these are basically, it's a diagram of the different types of seizures. Your assessment will depend on the type. So for example, here is focal motor, tonic-clonic movements of the upper or lower limb. So it could just go like that. That's focal, it's limited to that, it's focused on that part of your body. Okay, This one is visual seizures. You don't know you're having seizures, but it's actually like an aura. You're seeing flashes of light or scotoma. Scotoma are like
the little sprinkles,
black dots on your visual field.
Like when you get up in time.
Okay, and then this one is autonomic seizure. You get sweating, flashing, or pallor. Okay, and then sometimes grimacing. They will just like. Have you seen people with that? Like that Tourette syndrome. That's some kind of seizure, right? Have you seen Tourette syndrome?
Yes.
There used to be an NBA player with that syndrome.
NBA,
yeah. Lorenzo in the 80s.
Lorenzo Ball?
Not Lonzo.
He needs a seizure. Those shoes are overpriced.
I don't remember his name, but he used to go like that all the time. And Tourette, they curse a lot too. They would just, without their intention, they say something loud, rude, and...
McKenzie,
that's Tourette. They have seizures. Okay. So treatment, you know, when the patient's having a seizure, especially a generalized grand mal seizure, every muscle in your body, in the patient's body, is contracting, right? So that would leave the patient exhausted. Because just imagine all of your muscles are contracting all the time. Especially if it's status epilepticus. So he gets tired. So you give him adequate rest and good nutrition, avoid alcohol. Of course, you don't want a patient with frequent seizures to drive, right? It would be a recipe for disaster. And swimming, all right?
That one's not as bad as
And a medical alert tag, of course, that will tell people who will find him in seizure that what his diagnosis is. So the drugs, okay, these are favorite drugs of Hesse Pharma. You gotta master these drugs.
These are fast movers in the pharmacy.
Most, famous here anti-seizure drug is phenobarbital. Have you heard of this?
Yeah, you sell it every day.
Phenobarbital.
Because I'm a plug.
Even in pediatrics, before it was used a lot to control seizures. Then phenytoin or dilantin, the full name is...
It's a long one.
Sodium?
Diphenylhydantoin. Okay, that's the complete name. Diphenylhydantoin, shortened to phenytoin or dilantin. A favorite question here: side effect of gum hyperplasia. So they will ask you, what are the things to be avoided in patients taking a dilantin? And the answer is, use soft bristle toothbrushes because it will injure the gum hyperplasia. The gums will be swollen, and that can be injured by the hard bristles of the toothbrush.
And stink.
Okay. So, Tegretol, carbamazepine. So, sometimes the seizure is really bad to control, difficult to control. The doctor might give any combination of these drugs. They can be given in combination. It's not just one drug. Okay. Then, Tegretol, these are the side effects. Then for generalized seizure, you can use clonazepam or clonopin. Now, we've reached MS. We're almost done. I'll stop at 60. Still have 1:48. Multiple sclerosis, MS. Do you know what the problem is in MS? I told you about this earlier.
No sheaves, so no conduction.
Okay, demyelination. Okay, and what causes it? They believe it is an autoimmune disease. It's probably, most likely, it's an autoimmune disease. Where the patient's own T cells, remember the T cells from the thymus? Okay, this is the cellular immune systems. They will attack and destroy the myelin sheath. And so the neuron, the axon, will be stripped of the myelin sheath.
Okay.
By the attack of the T cells. Okay? Now, sometimes the myelin sheath can regenerate, and that will represent a remission. So the patient will improve.
Make that's a good outcome.
Seem normal, right? This is what happens. See, this is the normal neuron, right? This is the myelin sheath. This is the node of Ranvier. Remember the node of Ranvier for saltatory conduction? Okay, this is the normal. Then, little by little, the T cells will be eating on the, or attacking the,
so they eat
the myelin sheath until it's disrupted. Here, so there is no smooth transmission of the impulses. That's what happened with MS. Okay, the clinical manifestations, diplopia. What's diplopia?
It's two, yeah.
Double
two
vision. Frequently, that is the initial symptom. Very often, patient will first complain of diplopia. So if you get a patient who will be complaining of diplopia, you will be probably right if you think first of MS. Very common, more common in females than males. And there could be weakness of the limbs, weakness of the muscles, there could be incoordination. So if you have these all these problems, then there could also be sexual problems, right? And swallowing difficulties, because swallowing needs muscle action too. Okay, the nursing interventions, usually there is no specific treatment. Patient may be given ACTH. What I've heard is that they're all of these drugs is that they're trying to experiment with stem cells, stem cell research might restore the myelin sheath of the demyelinated parts of the nervous system. So stem cell therapy is a promising, I've read that it's a promising. I think they're doing it in most of Europe. The problem with this country is that we are a little behind in stem cell research because there were some political decisions before that stem cell research was, the funding for stem cell research was
controversial.
Okay, I think during the Bush and the Reagan administrations. So we fell behind from Europe and even Singapore is doing very well with their stem cell research.
It's the pirates. Okay.
And so these are the drugs. Valium, have you heard of Valium? It's a tranquilizer, right?
Diazepam.
Diazepam. Is it over the counter?
No, not
over.
But
I know.
Okay, it should prevent spasms. Okay.
I can give you the hookup, you know, but I have to take it off my YouTube.
Or uricolin, that is also used for neurogenic bladder. So the bladder can be partially or completely paralyzed, so that can help with the tone of the urinary bladder. Bactrim and Septra are antibiotics to help with urinary tract infections. Macrodantin, we mentioned this before, it's a urinary antiseptic, if you remember. Right? You learned this already last month, I think. Now, nursing care, well-balanced diet as needed.
For everybody.
Hot baths will increase weakness, so should be avoided. Will increase weakness. So you sometimes you feel that it's very comfortable, right? If you get a hot bath, okay, so you'd assume that it might be good for this patient. No, if the patient has MS, it will increase the weakness. So don't do that.
No hot tubs.
And learn to stabilize the gait by leaning toward the less involved side. So the better side.
Strong side.
Okay, the strong side. So you could probably use also a gait belt to help with that. Now, prognosis, we'll have a life expectancy, I think, from diagnosis of 25 years. Still not bad, right?
Yeah. You can do some things in 25 years. You can see a kid grow, get a few more DUIs.
If I get another 25 years, I'd be very happy.
Make the most of them 25 years.
Right? 25 years is a long time. Then Parkinson's disease is the third crippling disease in the United States. Do you know Muhammad Ali?
Yeah.
You know Michael J. Fox?
Not anymore, but yeah.
He's doing well with it.
Janet Reno? What did you say?
Michael J. Fox, he's doing well with it.
He's doing well with it?
Well, he had an art show before, but then he couldn't.
And
do it anymore.
Pope John Paul II was also suffering from that.
Really?
It's a pretty common among celebrities. No, it's a very common, actually. It's a third crippling disease. And what the problem is, again, is a deficiency of
dopamine.
Okay. So it's either the production of a dopamine or there is an increase in the enzyme that will lyse dopamine. Okay. So symptoms, this is very, very typical. Okay. There will be tremors, cogwheel rigidity, series of jerks when moving. You know what's a cogwheel? It's a wheel. There's a cog. it will move at one step at a time.
Oh.
One step at a time. So when you try to rotate this hand, you cannot do it smoothly. It has to be. You understand? That's cogwheel. So when you try to dance, you dance
like a strap.
Oh, he'd be good at pop locking, man.
How do you dance the strap?
I don't know.
You know, like the robot dance, probably. That's what I'm thinking.
Like,
because
you
yeah, you don't, you're not able to move that smoothly. So it's one step at a time, like the cog wheel.
Pop locking drop.
You understand what I'm saying? So that's cog wheel rigidity. Dyskinesia is the main problem. Slowing down of everything. Dyskinesia, slowing down of all muscle movements. And the facial expression is a mask. Light fussy. Mask light. What do you understand by mask light?
It hides the face. It's just one expression.
There's no change in expression. It's like when you're wearing a mask. If it's Batman smiling, then that will be the mask until you take it off. That will be the expression until you take it off. So no change in expression. And failure to swing the affected arm, and then propulsive gait. It's like they're always taking small steps and always like that, and then they have a tendency to fall down because of that propulsive gait. All right, so they slow down. Dyskinesia, right? Everything is slowed down, so they will have a hard time starting to walk.
Of course,
so their mind is already saying, "You walk," but still not walking. Then eventually they start moving, and then moving faster, propulsive gait, and then from here they see the wall. Then the thing is stopped, but it takes slowly to reach the muscles so that they will not stop immediately, and then they will eventually hit the wall, right? So that's dyskinesia and the propulsive gait. Sometimes there will be drooling of the saliva. So the problem here is in the globus pallidus, part of the basal ganglia of the brain and the substantia nigra. That is where most of the dopamine is being produced and released. There's a deficiency of the dopamine production. And this is another cartoon that will depict, I'm more than 60, right? Parkinson's disease. So onset is usually gradual, usually after age of 50, and slowly progressive. So Michael J. Fox, I think, was less than 50 when he was first diagnosed, I think. Right? It was like a long time ago. And I think Muhammad Ali was, part of it was due to the
George
trauma to the head from his career as a boxer.
The George Foreman fight.
So here, he's wearing a mask. Just remember this drawing. A little bit stooped. Okay, bradykinesia or dyskinesia, slowing down of all movement. There's also the characteristic pill rolling tremors. It's like you're rolling a pill. So they keep on doing like that.
Blunt rolling?
It's like they're rolling it like that all the time with their fingers. Even if there's no pill there, they're just doing it. Have you seen people with that tremor? It's probably Parkinson's. It's very common. This one, pill rolling tremors.
See, my wife might have it.
And shuffling propulsive gait. And it rarely occurs in the black population. And I think it's equally common between the sexes. So observation of the symptoms. So treatment, the part of the diagnosis would be, you give the patient this drug. It's actually L-DOPA, which is a form of dopamine. And if there's improvement, then you can say that this patient probably has Parkinson's disease. It's like testing. Giving what is needed, you give the carbidopa, and the patient improves. All right, so these are the medications, levodopa or Sinemet. Sinemet, I think, is the combination, Artane and Cogentin. Now, these are two other invasive procedures, ablation surgery and DBS. Ablation is destroying portions of the brain that control rigidity and tremors. So you just take it out. So there'll be no more rigidity and there'll be no tremors. DBS, on the other hand, is a newer technology. Deep brain stimulation, there's an electrode placed in the globus pallidus or in the hypothalamus to generate an impulse, okay? And you use this in patients not responding to meds, and I know that this is very effective. I know a patient in particular who has responded very well with this. The problem with ablation is you're already taking it out. So there's nothing to stimulate with DBS. So this will no longer work in patients with ablation. Who already had a previous ablation surgery. So you understand?
DBS
because
first.
You cannot. So this is a later technology. Some of them were already desperate, so they had this ablation surgery. This came out, then they're SOL, right? Because there's no more tissue to stimulate. Because it's already been ablated. It's already been taken out. And these are the nursing interventions, safe environment. Obviously, they are at risk for falls. All right. Of course, nutrition, you cut the food into bite sizes, finger food size, okay? Because why?
So they don't have aspiration.
Why would you prefer them to eat with their fingers rather than with spoon and fork or other utensils?
Well, because they might spill with the tremors and it promotes coordination.
Because it's easier for them than to manipulate tools, right? Because of their Parkinson's. They have tremors, they have dyskinesia. So they know what to do, but they cannot do it. So it's easier for them to handle the food. So you put them in bite sizes or finger food size, and you want to try to avoid constipation and suction when necessary. Like I told you, they might be drooling. They cannot swallow their saliva, or they have a problem swallowing. So the saliva tends to pool in the mouth. Of course, if it's overflowing, then they'll drool. And then they might choke on their own saliva, so you might need to suction the patient. You understand?
I need something from
SOS. Okay, come in. No problem. This is Miss Nancy Felix. She's our registrar. If any problem, no, she doesn't like problems. If you have something to fix with your Moodle, she's the person to go to. All right. And treatment and meds. So, with these words again, anticholinergic. Okay, levodopa, which is another synthetic form of dopamine. And the side effect is orthostatic hypotension. What is the universal nursing intervention for orthostatic hypotension?
Slow transitioning,
okay.
And dangling.
From supine to upright. Okay, you instruct the patient that all the time. Surgery, thalotomy, and so that's the ablation therapy, taking out the thalamus. There is also a Parkinsonian crisis. Okay. It's due to a sudden withdrawal of drugs. And symptoms will be severe exacerbation of tremors. So the patient will have more tremors than usual. There could be mental changes, increased attention span and memory. There could be confusion. So it's almost like although it's different, but it's sometimes they will manifest like what?
Dementia.
Dementia. Okay, what's the most common dementia in the United States?
Alzheimer's.
Alzheimer's disease. Which we'll discuss next week. So we'll end up here and then we'll have a break until it's quitting time.
And thus concludes this part. So if you guys have any questions or things you'd like to see, leave a comment. If you have any questions to go more in depth about this, turn on the next video. Leave a comment in the section. Don't forget to triple tap the like button.
Yeah.
See you guys next week.